It's Friday. Jesus is praying. Peter is asleep. Judas is betraying. But Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Pilate's struggling. Beat my Jesus. They robe him in scar. They crown him with thorns. But they don't know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary. His blood dripping. His body stumbling. And his spirit's burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The world's winning. People are sinning. And evil's grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nailed my Savior's hands to the cross. They nailed my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raised him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't know. It's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. He's hanging on the cross, feeling forsaken by his Father, left alone and dying. Can nobody save him? Oh, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, the earth trembles, the sky grows dark, my king yields his spirit. It's Friday, hope is lost, death has won, sin has conquered, and Satan's just a laugh. It's Friday. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard. And a rock is rolled into place. But it's Friday. It is only Friday. Sunday is a coming.
Everything that you and I believe, everything that we preach, everything that we teach, hinges on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It wasn't enough that he died. It wasn't enough that he was buried. The fact of the matter is, had he not gotten up, he'd been just like us, just like any other man. But I'm glad the story ends well. He got up. Amen. And because he got up, some glorious daybreak, all those who put their faith in Christ and lay in a cemetery, they're going to get up on resurrection morning. Amen? And the Bible says that we'll meet him in the air and forever we'll be with the Lord. What a wonderful promise that is in Scriptures. Amen? If that don't bless you, your blessing's broke. Amen? That's what we've come here to do today, is to recognize and to worship the risen Lord. He said, I am he that was dead, but am alive, and behold, am alive forevermore, thank God, and have the keys of death and of hell. Takes a bad businessman not to have the keys to his own place of business, does it? Jesus said, I got them, and I've had victory over them, amen. I'll just keep them right here in my pocket, amen. And so I'm glad about that this morning. Glad to see you here. You are so, y'all are decked out. Y'all clean up nice. I'm telling you what, I'm impressed. Sister Crystal, we got some good-looking folk here, don't we? Amen. Good to have you with us, our home folk, as well as our visitors. And we got a lot of visitors today, and there's no way in the world I could name all of you, but we're just delighted that you're here, and we're just going to sit back a little while and recognize our wonderful, wonderful Savior. And I'm so glad you're here with us to do that. Amen. Brother Ben and Haley, would you come lead us to the throne?
Good morning. It's Sunday. Thank God it is Sunday. Pray with me now. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day of days. Dear God, I'm glad it ain't Friday no more. Amen. Dear Father, we look upon Friday as it being good, dear Lord. How good it was for us, dear Father, when you hung suspended between heaven and earth for our sins and for our namesake. But dear God, it didn't stop there, thank goodness. Dear God, you took 3 days and you took care of your business. Dear Father, you took the keys, as the pastor has already said, of hell. And you hold them now, dear Father, because on the third day, which is today, this glad day of all days, dear Father, you arose victorious. O death, where is thy sting? The scriptures tell us, dear Father, you have defeated one, dear God, that we cannot even come close to, because you are God Almighty. Dear fathers, the scriptures tell us that your mother came to the sepulcher, dear Father, where the stone was rolled away, not by man's hand, but by the hand of God Almighty. And you stepped out of there, and you ascended to the Father, and you took your rightful place beside him, dear God, and with you we stand victorious this very day. Amen. Because those that believe on you, dear God, today are sons and daughters of Christ. And we will be victorious with you, dear Father. You say that we will share heaven with you for all eternity because of what you did, because of nothing that we did, only believing on the name of the Son. Dear God, whatever we bring here today don't mean nothing. Whatever we brought here today, dear Lord, don't mean a thing. Today we came to bring homage and worship to a true and risen Savior, one that has risen from the dead, one today that we can cling to when we need him, one that shall never, ever forsake us. Dear Father, you tell us that. God, I ask you today to worship now with us today with your ascension. Dear God, we come to you in love. We ask, dear Father, that everything we do today brings glory to your name. Yes. In the name of the Father, I send these prayers. Amen.
Blood of Calvary's Lamb. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed.
Not a word was heard at the tomb that day, just shuffling soldiers' feet as they guarded the grave. One day, 2 days, 3 days had passed. Could it be that Jesus had breathed his last? Or could it be that his Father had forsaken him, turned his back on his Son, despising our sin? All hell seemed to whisper, just forget him, he's dead. Then the Father looked down to the Son and said, arise, my love, arise. More suffering, hurry. earth trembled and the tomb began to shake. Then like lightning from heaven, the stone was rolled away. And his dead men, the guards, they all stood there in fright as the power of love displayed its might. Then suddenly a melody filled the air, riding wings of wind, it was everywhere. Words of creation have been longing to hear the sweet sound of victory. So loud and clear. Arise, my love. Arise, my love. For the grave.
Go from here. I'm stunned already. Oh man. Matthew chapter 28, if you have your Bibles. Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28, we'll read verses 1 through 6. You find your places, if you'd stand, please. Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 6. And the word of the Lord says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the woman, fear not ye. For I know that ye seek Jesus who was crucified. Boy, I love this verse. I got it highlighted twice in my Bible. It says, he is not here, for he is risen as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay. You may be seated. Pray with me, please. Father God in heaven, as I come before you, Lord, I have a request for myself. Help me preach as a dying man to dying men. Lord, help us to preach as though this were the last time we'd ever stand in this place. My heart is already overflowed. Lord, because of the passion I feel right now, I'll never be able to make it if you don't help me. Just thank you so much for thinking of me so much. Lord, there's nothing good that I've done. There's nothing that I deserve. None of us do, Lord. But this whole beautiful story and this whole beautiful day has so much to do with how much you love us. How much you cared about us, that you'd be willing to go through what you had to go through so that we could go free. And Lord, whom you make free, the Bible says is free indeed. And all of us here today, we raise our hands in worship and praise and adoration to you, Lord, because we understand that. We understand the great lengths you went through. You took our cross. You took our punishment. You took our judgment. You took our hell. And you placed them upon your back, the just for the unjust, that we might become the righteousness of God through you. Amen. Oh, what a Savior. How could we walk away from the house of God today and not have a relationship with you, Lord? I'll never understand that, but some will. And the Bible says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? Father, I pray that this few minutes we would each consider the cost, consider the sacrifice that you paid so that we could find forgiveness of sins. We could be pardoned, the criminal pardoned and set free. Father, bless your word now as it goes forth. I pray if there's someone here unsaved, I pray today would be the glad day of salvation. Lord, I pray for the young man that just went back with Brother Avon. I don't know the need, but you do. And Lord, I pray that you would meet it. And there are many others of us here today that need to make the same motion. And I pray, God, we'd be obedient to you through the working of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I apologize for being so emotional. Today is always, for me, the most wonderful day in the world. You say, preacher, I don't like all that emotionalism. Well, that's all right. You have your choice. But the way I see it, I was a hell-bound sinner. I deserve the deepest, darkest dungeons of hell for all eternity because I'm a sinner. Old Pastor Paul, the sinner. Well, we're all in that boat. The scripture says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I deserved what Christ took on the cross. We each did. But right then and there, Jesus stepped in between me and the Father in judgment and said, Father, if he owes you anything, if he's wronged thee in any way, I want you to put it on my account. Well, I've wronged him in a lot of ways in 45 years. And there's a lot of stuff that's been wiped off my account and put onto his. But that day on Calvary, the blood of Jesus Christ took care of it all. For all sin, for all mankind, for all time. The most beautiful love story we've ever heard. is for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. He that hath the Son hath life, but he that hath not the Son hath not life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. See, we have a choice today to kneel at the cross or refuse it. Boy, I hope you choose it today if you hadn't already. There's no guarantee of another service. There's no guarantee of another Sunday. There's no guarantee of another Easter. We got it today. And by divine appointment, you're here with us. You're going to hear the word. You've already heard it. I'm going to preach to you for an hour and a half, and then you make your decision. That's just the way it is. Amen. Don't get nervous. Some of you started popping pills and stuff. You got all scared. I'm just kidding. Hour at the most. Today, and I don't need to tell you this, you know it as well as I do, but our world is full of empty promises, isn't it? I mean, it's full of empty promises. And if you went nowhere else but in front of your Sanyo or your Emerson or your Philips TV, you wouldn't have to go any further to be able to agree with me, because it's full of empty promises with all of its advertisements that tell us we can be happy, that tell us we can be sexy. Most of them are trying to tell me when I'm looking at it that I can be sexy. Well, I know they're lying. That ain't gonna happen. But they got false advertisement that tell you you can be rich, or that you could be famous, or that you could be wrinkle-free, or that you can look like these beautiful ladies they have on TV, or, hey, do this for 90 days, Reverend McLeod, and you can look like Lou Ferrigno. Well, we tried it, didn't we, brother? It didn't work. But they tell us these things. If we'll buy certain products, we can be beautiful, and we can be, you know, just have this chiseled out body, and everything's wonderful, and we're happy, and life's just a breeze, and it's all good. And if you just live in a little while, you understand that it's really not the truth. But here's the thing, it's not long before we've watched it so much that we fall for it, don't we? They fool us, and we buy into it, and we go buy those products, and we try to get rid of all the problems that we think we have so that we can be problem-free and happy and rich and famous and beautiful and sexy and all those things, right? But, you know, after the fourth or fifth product, you finally start to realize, hey, this is the way it's going to be. That's not going to work. I lifted weights for a long time. You can't tell it. I tried everything they had. I mean everything they had. And I still look like Barney Fife. It didn't work. I spent hundreds of dollars on stuff that don't work. I guess you've probably been listening to these candidates running for president. I mean, these cats are something. You don't know who to believe. You don't know who to trust. They've got all of the answers, yet they have no answers. They'd rather climb a tree and lie and stand on the ground and tell the truth. They'll lie when the truth will do just as good. They lie on each other. And you look at that mess and you say, who in the world wants to vote for somebody? I wouldn't vote for nobody that runs somebody else down all the time. But they do. And we get caught up in those things. Empty promises. The government. This will be on TV, but that's okay. I'm not going to say anything bad about them, except we need to pray for them. We need to pray for them, but I really, truly don't believe they have our best interests in mind. I don't think they care about us no more than the man on the moon. Oh, they'll promise you a lot of stuff. But what I hear you saying in the coffee shop most of the time is they never come through. But more, we really need to pray for them. I'll say that. It's our duty to pray for them, whether we agree with them or disagree with them. It's our duty to do that. But I could go on and on and on about empty promises, and I could go right on down to marriage. I know at least 50% of the time we don't mean what we say. When we say for richer or poor, better or worse, sickness and in health, Basically, you're saying, regardless whether it's good, bad, or ugly, I'm going to stay with it. That's what I believe. That's my conviction. That's my vow. That's my promise. That's my oath to you. 50% of the time, it don't work. 50% of the time, that was an empty promise when you stood at the altar and you told that woman you was going to stay with her. And you out there running around with some other chessy cat. It's just empty promises. It don't mean anything. I can tell you right now, at least 3 times this week, I've had a man shake my hand. I've had a man shake my hand, said, I'll be there at a certain time. You got my word on it. When you shake your hand, that's making a vow right there. I'm going to be there. At least 3 times this week, never saw him. Empty promises, didn't mean a thing. And the world's full of those things. We look around us and we have high hopes for different things in society and in life and our families and the whole nine yards, but they're just empty promises. They don't mean a thing. There's no guarantees with it. I said all that to say this. You and I serve a God today that's totally different. You and I serve a God today that's totally different than that. Instead of promises full of emptiness, God gives us some emptiness that's full of promise. Amen. And I want to share 3 of those things with you real quick. And we're about 45 minutes out and we can go hunt Easter eggs. The 3 things are, and this is not no great brilliant outline. It's not, but you can't improve on the story. You just can't. We were out here praying earlier. Reverend McLeod was giving the benediction out here at the cemetery. And I was so proud when he said, we don't have the kind of words we need to express our thanks for what you've done. Well, we don't have the kind of words we need to express this story. It's good enough with all by itself. It don't need me to help it. It don't need anybody else to help it. It's beautiful just the way it is. So the 3 points are an empty cross, an empty tomb, and empty grave clothes. 3 things. So let's look at the empty cross first. Let's go back to that first Easter morning. It's early dawn, just like it was this morning when we gathered here. The sun hadn't risen yet. And there's several ladies who are making their way to the tomb. And I can just imagine in my mind's eyes, they were going down the path to that tomb. And as they got up on the hill of that path, there in that pink horizon, they looked over and stopped, just motionless, quiet. And over in that horizon, there stood 3 crosses. A solemn reminder of the horror that they just experienced a couple of days ago. And I can imagine one of them saying, just look at that middle one. Because that's the one, the man we're going to see now. Died on. You see the blood there on the top of the post? That's the blood that came from the crown of thorns that was crushed down upon his head. And you see the blood on the 2 side posts. That's where they nailed his hands. And then the main beam that runs down the middle, you see the blood that just soaked that main beam. That came from the back of our Savior, whose skin was stripped off with the cat of nine tails. And there at the foot of the cross, the blood that just poured from his body as he was speared in the side to make sure that he was dead. And by the way, friends, he was. He was dead. There are some who claims he wasn't dead. He just went into some kind of medical condition and passed out. But that's hogwash. That's what I want you to see today. That's what we're here for. I want you to see the cross. I want you to see the empty cross. The place where he died today, it's empty. He's not there. He's not there. The cross is empty, but it's full of God's promises, isn't it? The empty cross is full of God's promises. Listen to Peter. He says, "For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Who when he was reviled, reviled not again. And when he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. Who in his own self bare our sins in his body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye are healed." Revelations 1:5 says, "And from Jesus, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood." Jesus paid the penalty for our sins. Peter said again, "For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold, received from your vain conversation, received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh." Thank God today for an empty cross. You and I will never have to pay for one sin. You and I will never have to spend one day in hell. You and I will never have to go under God's wrath because of our sins, because they've been wiped out by the blood of Jesus Christ. I thank God today my children will never have to go to hell. My mom and daddy, I'm going to be in heaven with them forever and ever and ever. Amen. I'm going to be in heaven with all of you. I'm going to be in there with Reverend McLeod and Brother Will and Brother Lyles and all of you because of what Jesus Christ did. Amen. A long, long time ago. Oh, the thought that my children, who are sinners as well as your children, who are sinners as well as their father and mother, will never have to spend one day in hell if they'll repent and be washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. Come kneel at the cross and find forgiveness today. That's the message of the empty cross. I like the way J. Danson Smith put it. He said, "Was it for me he bowed his head upon the cross and freely shed his precious blood, that crimson tide? Was it for me the Savior died? It was for me. Yes, all for me. O love of God, so great, so free, O wondrous love, I'll shout and sing, he died for me, my Lord and King." If you'd have been the only one here, if you'd have been the only one here, he'd have come and done the same thing. Because he loves you so much. Isn't that a wonderful thought? Isn't that a wonderful thought? Let's get back to our ladies. After they pause briefly viewing the cross, they begin to make their way to the tomb to go do the task, the sad task that they were about to do. They made their way there to anoint the body of Jesus. Before they got there, the scripture says the ground began to quake. The ground began to tremble. And these are ladies now going to a tomb. I told them this morning, most ladies get scared when a storm cloud comes over in July. But here's three ladies all by themselves, and they're down a path going to a tomb, and all of a sudden the world begins to shake. Can you imagine being there? They begin to shake, and they look at each other. And I imagine they're probably fearful. The Bible doesn't get into great detail about every little thing that happened, but can you just imagine three women going to a tomb and the world begins to, you know, the whole thing's just shaking. Stones falling down, trees falling over. And I imagine that they were frightened. And then it stops. And they continue toward the tomb. And as they come upon this tomb, they see something even that may even be more frightening to them, but definitely unexplainable, and that is that the guards who are guarding this tomb, they're all laying down. The Bible says that they were dead. And not only that, but the stones rolled away. I can't figure out how these ladies thought they were going to move it anyway. Can you, Brother McLeod? I mean, from what they tell us, that thing probably weighed 2 tons. Right? So I can see Darlene and Kathy and and Debbie and Carolyn walking down there to anoint the body of Jesus, and there's a 2,000-pound stone in the way, not to mention all these guards who has set a seal upon it, and it can't be moved unless they give you permission anyway. I don't know what they was thinking, but that's what they were going to go do. And they got there, and all that stuff was done, which was good, but unexplainable. Can you imagine that? And they got there, and there was an angel sitting there. And the Bible says he was glowing like lightning. And he said, Darlene, Kathy, can you imagine him saying, I know why you come here. You came here seeking Jesus, didn't you? He said, well, I got some good news for you. That old boy ain't here. He got up. He rose up and walked out of here just a little while ago. He ain't here. And I don't know. I imagine they had a hallelujah. They had a Pentecostal fit. I know they did. I know they did. And I ain't mad at them. I'm glad. The tomb was empty. Jesus had risen just like he said he would do 3 days later. You see, the empty tomb is full of God's promises. The empty tomb is full of God's promises. Listen to Paul in Corinthians. He says, for since by one man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all died, but listen to this, folks, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Hallelujah. I remember when I was a little fella. I'll call you out now, I will. But don't worry, fellas, I ain't calling you out. My faithful five reading group, they think, you all right, brother, you okay. I will call you out, though. And my mama said to me the other day, she said, you always bragging on your daddy. How come you never say nothing good about me? The Holy Spirit told her to say that to me so I could say what I'm going to say to you today. Right? Well, I remember being a little fella. And we didn't have all these gadgets like y'all got, this fancy stuff. Rhonda K, my sister right here, we had to create stuff to do. You know, mama would tell us to go outside. We didn't stay in the house all day. We had to go in the yard or in the woods or somewhere. And we had to make our own stuff up. I had a basketball and a baseball, but Rhonda K didn't like that too much. So she had a couple Barbie dolls. I didn't like that too much. But we would play and we would create things. We used to go in the woods and we'd dig tunnels through the woods and we'd build little tree houses. And we had some neighbors and stuff like that. And we'd go in the woods and we'd climb these little, I don't know if y'all ever done it or not, but this was my favorite thing to do. But you find a right size hickory nut tree. And they tough, you know. You climb up in that thing and get the top of it and you just hold on to swing off of it. And that thing will just take you right on down. Y'all ever done that? Anybody ever done that? Bubba, you did that? Jimmy, I thought I was the only one. My Lord, look at Andre raising his hand. I did that down in Rimini. But we did those things, but I can remember so much. I can remember, we didn't have no swimming pool. Nobody else had one either. I'm getting old. Nobody had no swimming pool. But we had the dirt road that we lived on. If it rained in any amount at all, we'd get a mud hole. We'd get two of them. We'd get one going that way and one going, and we'd go swimming in mud holes and playing in mud holes, all us chilling down there together with the ringworms, the tadpoles, toad frogs. It didn't matter. Back then, it didn't matter. We got in there with them and we played with them. We all had a good time. We'd throw tadpoles at each other or whatever, but we had a good time. And I remember those days, and I remember my next door neighbor's name was Skipper. And he was a fat little fella. He was bigger around than he was tall. And I looked like I had something wrong with me. I mean, I was about big around as that thing right there. And we just told it, but I love Skipper. And he'd be playing in that mud hole and walling around that thing. And he'd be filthy, dirty, and walling around like an old walrus. And all the rest of us would see him. And we'd run down in front of the house and we'd all get in that thing, all the little boys and all the little girls. And I remember those things and just good times. But that's what we would do during the day. And then When Mama was home, she'd call us. She'd call us home for supper. And that thing can cook. This is where you come in. Ain't nobody in the world can cook like my mama, except my wife. They're running pretty tight. y'all still got an extra room at the house if I need to come. But she could, there were certain days of the week that she always cooked, because she worked. She worked a hard job, and on those nights, we had so much supper. And she can't cook for one day. It'd be 2 or 3 days worth of food there. But, you know, good fried chicken and rice and gravy. Quit licking your lips, Jim. Macaroni and cheese. Sometimes she'd roll these dumplings out on the kitchen table. She'd make homemade dumplings and roll them out on the table. She had this old roller, and she'd roll them out, bless her heart. And she'd cut them things up in little strings about that long, about that wide. And she'd put them in there with some chicken and season that thing just right. And I'm telling you what, it wasn't nothing like it in the world. I remember that. I remember those cathead biscuits. She used to make the prettiest little biscuits. And they're flat, just right, moist, you know. You didn't need nothing else. That and a piece of fat bag, you said. It didn't matter. You know? I got hypertension now because of it, but I had a good time back then with it. But I remember that. I remember those times sitting around the table. My mom and daddy, my sister, a family, a place where you were welcome. A place that was warm and loving. And you knew it. And you knew they wanted to be there. And you knew they wanted to be with you. And I said all that to say this. It was wonderful sitting around my mama's table. But one day Jesus Christ is going to step out on that balcony of heaven. And he's going to say, children, it's supper time. It's supper time. I want you to come to the table. And you and I are going to go dine with divinity. We're going to go dine with sovereignty around that heavenly table at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Amen. And I bet them biscuits will be big as hubcaps, Bubba. I bet it's going to be good over yonder. Folks, without the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we wouldn't have that kind of hope. We wouldn't have that kind of future. We'd have no hope beyond the grave. We'd have no hope beyond death. We'd have no hope beyond the empty promises of this world. But today, because of an empty tomb, our lives are full of promises that we'll go and be with the Savior. Isn't that wonderful? And you didn't start that love affair, by the way, he did. My wife chased me. She started it. It's her fault. And I think about the relationship that I so much enjoy with Christ. He started. The Bible says he loved us we love him because he first loved us. Isn't that wonderful? The empty tomb gives us so many empty promises because he got up and he walked out. Some glorious daybreak, all of us who put our faith in him, we're going to get up and walk out. We walked over there this morning, during the sunrise service, and there were several people with us that had loved ones buried over here. And I'll just share one with you. I don't know if many of you know this. Brother Lamb, is this okay? Several years ago, Brother Lamb lost his son, Jeremy Ray Lamb, in a drowning accident. He's 3 years old, wouldn't he, brother? I couldn't imagine. You look around at the boat ramp, and you can't see that baby. And just a little while ago, we walked over here to the cemetery. There's Jeremy's little grave. Got it decorated, little flowers all around it. Got an alligator sitting on top of it. And we got to thinking, some golden daybreak, old Jeremy's going to get up. He's going to get up out of that watery grave. Junior's going to see him. And Betty's going to see him. And Desiree's going to see him. And Jeremy's going to see them. And they're going to all be together again. And I tell you what, I promise you, they'll never be separated again. For all eternity, they'll live on the other side with Jesus and be together where there is no goodbyes. Isn't that wonderful? We can say all those things because of what we celebrate today, the resurrection of our Lord. He's alive. He's risen. I thank God that he got up. He said, I am the resurrection and life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Folks, I'm telling you today, when a man can get up and walk out of his grave, he's anybody that he says he is, and he can do anything that he says he can do. That's all I got to say. That tomb's empty. I thought about this too. There's a lot of cemeteries in the world. I think about the pyramids in Egypt, where the popular Egyptians were buried. And those things are famous. And people go and they see mummified bodies, don't they? I think about the Arlington Cemetery, where our famous military people are buried. And people go there and they visit those places because of who's there. And the Westminster Abbey and others all over the world. I did a funeral one time over at the military cemetery in Florence, and I was just amazed. And people go there and they visit. But you know what makes those things famous, those places famous? It's what they're famous and they draw visitors because what they contain. But the tomb of Jesus is famous because what it don't contain. It's totally opposite, isn't it? They're famous because they're full. But the tomb's famous because, thank God, it's empty. An empty cross, an empty tomb. And then empty bed linen. That means something. That's very significant. The Bible says Jesus folded his grave napkin. They tell me that over in Israel, when you go and visit a restaurant, that everybody gets a napkin. And so if you're in that restaurant and you need to be excused or you need to go to the restaurant, that you'll take that napkin and you'll fold it a certain way. And you'll set it on the table. And when somebody passes by, they see that napkin. What that napkin says when they fold it that way is that, don't let anybody occupy this place. I'm coming back. But there's another way those folds of Jew that those Jews will fold that thing. That'll tell somebody when they pass by, go ahead and give this to somebody else. I ain't coming back here no more. And I believe that morning, on resurrection morning, when those disciples ran in that tomb, Jesus had folded that napkin in such a way to tell you go ahead and give this thing to somebody else because I ain't coming back here no more. Amen. I am he that was dead and alive, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Hallelujah. He's alive. He's alive. Hallelujah to God. He's alive. And because he's alive, my friend, you and I will never, ever, ever have to die. Isn't that wonderful? Because he lives, the song says, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds the future, and life is worth the living because he lives. Amen. Because he lives, we have a future that's out of this world. Amen. There's no need to be fearful. There's no need to be afraid. You say, preacher, what does tomorrow hold? I don't know, but I know who holds tomorrow. Because of an empty cross, an empty tomb, and empty bed closes, I know my future's secure. I know my salvation's secure. I know where I'm going to be for all eternity. And you know what? You can too if you put your trust in Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. He that believeth on me, he that believeth on me shall have everlasting life. Do you know him today? Do you know him? Do you have a relationship with him? Have you received the gift of salvation? that he so freely extends. It won't cost you anything. You won't have to pay for it. You can't afford it, no way. The world can't afford it. You can't be good enough to get it. You don't have to stop anything. Just trust him. Just come to him. You say, I don't want to quit doing this, and I don't want to have to quit doing that. Don't. Don't. Salvation ain't about a bunch of rules that we keep to obtain it. You'll never make it trying to keep rules. I ain't going to smoke no more. I ain't going to lie no more. I'm not going to cheat no more. I'm not going to cuss no more. I'm not going to gamble no more. I'm not going to lie about my fish no more. I'm not going to lie about the spread. I'm not going to lie about the golf score no more. I'm quit looking at women or whatever y'all do. I don't know what y'all do. You never make it. You will never make it. You will never make it trying to keep a list of rules. I'm telling you something to help you today. Quit trying to keep a list of rules and get involved in a relationship with Jesus Christ. You fall in love with him, he'll help you with them rules. Amen. You let him do the changes. You let him do the transforming, because you can't without the power of the resurrected Savior. Hallelujah.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we ask that you help us to reach those who are listening and those we meet, to come from the hedges and highways, compelled to come to Wedgefield Baptist Church, not knowing why they're coming, but when they get here, they will not want to leave, because they feel the Spirit of the Lord is at work here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.